almost smaller, but like smaller in a good way. Like,
there we go. We're recording, by the way, for all the lads and lasses joining in. Ruben's popping a flex. I don't know why, but it feels good right now.
He's looking like slim. Like he's looking, and I mean, by his standards, I mean, like he's looking.
By
he's
my
looking,
standards, this is slim.
Yeah, he's looking slim. He's looking like quite toned down. Not a lot of wasted space.
Not a lot of wasted space for all the fat.
I don't know if it's just the lighting, but I feel like you're 13% body fat right now.
I guessed 15. Because I want to be conservative.
Like, little fat. Yeah. So
I'm not going to show my abs yet. By the way, this is just for me doing some boxing. Because me and Tarquin's fight is back on for whoever's watching.
Like, it is back on.
If they didn't click off from the male
pornography. Yes. Absolutely. It is still going to be back on. Now, today's
I've been boxing a little bit, and it's definitely helping me burn some calories. But, I must say, shadow boxing for some reason seems to make me sweat a lot. So,
boxing is horrific. Like, if you actually go, if you're actually fucking, because the thing is that you can pussy for shadow boxing, you can be like, but if you fucking going for it, you sprawling, okay, well, you're not sprawling because it's boxing, well, but you
I've been practicing combos essentially, so it's like, I know what I'm gonna do, but I'll just repeat it over and over and over and over again.
Well, folks, the introduction to this podcast is brought to you by Eskom, South Africa's
electricity service of the country.
Use promo code fucking 10 o'clock to 11:30 to receive your rolling blackouts coming to your third world country daily. So
that for those of you who don't know, Eskom, South Africa.
Yeah.
In South Africa, we have this thing called load shedding, which is essentially because the government was too fucking stupid 10 years ago to realize we're going to run out of power because we don't have enough coal processing plants. We're in a nice nationwide situation where we don't have enough power. So what they do is they go to all the people who actually pay for power, because this doesn't happen in communities where people don't pay for power because they live in shacks. Nothing wrong with people who live in shacks, but I mean, this is a bit of a gripe of mine. They don't get the load shedding, but the people who live, like middle class people who happen to pay for electricity, they get the load shedding. So, you know, that we essentially get cut off a couple of times a week because they want to shed the load of the burden.
Can I call you Ruben? Nothing wrong with people who live in shacks from Rensburg. Like
I feel like I'm going to be quoted on like some, nothing wrong with people.
You're boarding on some like Joe Biden territory here. You know, when you really think about it, it's like people that live in shacks are just as smart.
That's Joe Biden.
No. I'm doing the other. People that live in shacks are just as intelligent as folks that live on golf courses and folks that live on mansions. Poor kids are just as smart as white kids. Ruben, that went further over your head than the fucking SAR bomb bar testing in Russia. But anyway, moving on to...
I'm sorry, Tarquin. We both know I'm terrible at first stuff. But I just realized this jersey is not going to work.
No, you're a really nice guy. Just, you know, so sometimes...
Just semi-retarded.
Semi-retarded.
Socially retarded. Speaking of
social retardation, Israel Adesanya's main gripe with Paulo Costa in sorry, Izzy, had to do you like that.
That for a transition right there, by the way. So this is what we're gonna talk about.
Smoother.
Yeah.
So
by the way, at this point,
our audience will catch on with it if we just talk about it.
99% of the people have clicked off this video. You know that, right? At this point, 99% of the people are no longer watching this video.
This video is going out to the true bruise. This video is going out to the cat.
The 1%, the YouTube 1% who actually enjoy watching us talk shit for 5 minutes.
Because the 1% of Brewcast fans own as much glory as 99% of
YouTube. In the name of that, give me 1 second.
Ah, Ruben popping his glutes right onto that fucking live stream. Jesus. getting overheating. I have to fucking take my jersey off. Yeah, Jesus, I like this, having this little YouTube platform to myself. Anyway, Ruben just went to go and fucking do
Yeah, salt. I need sugar for my coffee. I don't eat sugar. The only thing I eat sugar in is coffee, because you can't have coffee without sugar.
I would be worried if you just ate sugar. Yeah.
Well, no, but I mean, like, I don't eat sugar in food either, really.
Well.
No. I mean, one, I don't really eat processed food unless it's bologna, because I love bologna. Okay. And, but my diet, generally speaking, doesn't have that much sugar. My only, the thing, I don't eat sweets, even though I like sweets, I don't eat sweets. My thing that I love is dried fruit. I'm like a dried fruit guy.
Okay.
I love dried peaches and dried mangoes, like the small peaches. So for me, when people get candy, I get dried fruit. That's like my thing.
Right. So you probably weren't listening to latest hit single by Cardi B, Wet Ass Peach, because you prefer the dried fruit. You follow me?
Yes, I prefer the dry peaches.
You prefer the dried fruit, right?
Peaches are the best often.
Right, because you're kind of on like the Ben Shapiro.
You know why? It's all got to do with the friction of the tongue, because wet on peaches, peaches. Yes, we're talking about peaches, Tarquin. Wet peaches don't have the same texture, and that's a problem because the texture of dry peaches is just better. It tastes, yeah. It makes you secrete more saliva.
That's an interesting spin on it. You hit it with the old Uno reverse card. Now, exactly. What I was saying about our boy, about our look, I'm not gonna lie, Izzy is looking like.
Okay, but before you say anything, let's just say, okay, guys, at this point the video starts. We're gonna talk about Paulo Costa and Israel.
No,
we're
rolling the whole thing. Ruben, shut up. We don't need, let
people know what we're going to do, because it's actually kind of...
No, they're ready for the title. They're smart enough, dude. If they click we can't be intermediating, going like, okay, right, and go. I mean, it's a podcast. We just got to talk.
I know, but I just kind of want to say what topic we're going to. By the way, Tarquin, our audience, fortunately, is not made of 12-year-olds. I have demographics because of the Paulo Costa video. Most of them are between 8. We have our biggest segment is I think 25 to 35, but our second biggest is 18 to 25, and then our third biggest is 35 plus. So we're like sitting snugly between 18 and 35.
So why do you intermediate each episode? They can roll on. We can just talk naturally.
Okay, I'm sorry. So let's talk now. I'm sorry.
Let's talk now.
Okay, Izzy and Costa. Who's going to win, Tarquin? Who's going to whoop whose ass? And don't be like these pussy fucking... Damn.
Gratefully, I think... I know, not bad. Not bad, dude. Fucking wait. Where's my lighting? Oh, dude. Oh, shit, lighting. There we go.
Well, Tarquin, let's go back to the previous body fat video. You flexed and you couldn't see your abs at all, you remember that. So you like, I was being nice. I was like, well, Tarquin, the quality's bad, but I couldn't see your abs. Like, go back and look at it. Now I can. So you've lost quite a bit of body fat. Yes.
Right. I basically just started filling. I just stopped filling my face with shit. That's literally all it. I didn't even do cardio. I was just like, maybe don't eat pizza every evening. But going on to who's going to win, look, regretfully, I'd be a liar if I said that I don't think that Israel Adesanya is going to win. I love Paulo Costa. I love Paulo Costa, but I just, yeah. It's like I'd be in a strange situation where if I wanted to earn money, I'd bet on Izzy. I'd be happy if Costa won, but I'd lose all my savings. Does that make any sense? That's kind of the position that I'm in. It's an unfortunate. But at the same time, look, if Costa does just maul Izzy, I'm not going to be like, how on earth did that happen? That's not going to, I won't inherently be surprised, but I don't think it's going to happen. Ruben, over to you.
Okay, well, everyone knows I want Costa to win because I like Jack dudes fighting. Because, look, if here's the thing. If Izzy was more jacked than Costa, I'd want Izzy to win. So my bias is I want the most muscular guy to win. Because that's my thing. It's stupid in the MMA sense because it does fuck all relevance to whether you're a... It's not like I prefer seeing kickboxers win instead of fucking Muay Thai people, you know? It's like, I don't care about that. I just like watching jacked people kick people's asses. So because somewhat because I like the way he fights because he's like a fucking fridge who's just super explosive and marches into people. And I will say, if anyone who's not a technically a position striker, if I can say, if any one of those people was going to kick Israel's ass, it's Costa. If any person who isn't a technical striker, you mean like in the sense that Izzy is a technical striker, is going to kick Izzy's ass, it's going to be Costa. So if he can't do it, I have doubts anyone else in middleweight will be able to do it. So I want him to win. And here's what I'm going to say. We know it's going to be in a smaller cage, which I think gives Paolo an advantage because Izzy has less space to back up and duck and create opportunities, I would say. That might be a stupid thing to say, but I think that's a relatively safe thing to say. What I will say is look, I went and watched a whole bunch more of Izzy's fights. Well, highlights, really. I didn't go... I've watched a couple of his fights, like full fights. But
highlights are good enough.
I've watched three of his full fights, or more than that, not just three. And then I've watched compilations and shit like that, right? Because I'm not going to go watch every single one of the man's fights. But here's what I think. He's super technically skilled, more than I even thought he was when we made the first prediction video. Yeah. Because at that point, I hadn't watched as much. He's more skilled than I thought. And so here's the thing. I think if he pulls out his skills, he'll be able to work around Costa being explosive. But here's the thing. If he can't, Costa's going to whoop him. So if he can't make... If he's intimidated when that fight starts, I feel like Costa's going to have him on the ropes. I feel like if he can keep his cool and work the way he normally does, he's gonna tear Costa apart, right? He'll just lay him out. He'll just lay him out. But if he's intimidated when that fight starts, Costa's going to whoop him. So I actually don't think this is going to be a very long fight in all likelihood. I think this will probably end round two or three, I think, to be honest with you.
Calling it, like, if you have to call it, you're going to go round two, TKO or knockout?
Here's what I think. Do you know what what would be really funny? If we had a George Masvidal situation where Paolo came in and then Izzy just fucking ducks and fucking hooks him right across the chin and he just knocks him out instantly. Okay. I feel like for some reason, I have this feeling. If that happens, it would be really cool, but I want Costa to win. But, I mean, that would be a freak accident, right? That isn't supposed to happen. But here's kind of the way I see it going. It's going to go... There's three possible ways. One, Izzy's going to dominate from the start because Paolo's just not going to be able to get to him, right? Because Paolo needs to hit him. If he hits him, he's fine. But Izzy's so... But I mean that like in a technical way. If Izzy can hop around him and not get hit and just counter like he normally does, he's fine. If Paolo can hit Izzy, I mean can actually get in the pocket and land punches and not fall to Izzy's kind of counters. And if Paolo has enough sense to be able to not get hit when Izzy, because you know Izzy throws counters and people just get hit. It's like it's almost inevitable. When he counters, people don't see it coming and they don't block. They get fucking hit. Yeah. So here's the thing. I see it going one of three ways. One, Izzy's going to be dominant from the start. Paolo's not going to hit him, and Izzy's going to win. Two, Izzy's going to be off his guard, and Paolo's going to whoop his ass, and Izzy's counters are not going to work. I don't know how Paolo would do that, but he's just going to dominate him. Or three, it's going to be a back and forth and a back and forth until whoever gets tired. And unfortunately, I think if it comes down to that, Paolo's going to gas by round three.
Interesting.
And then I think Adesanya will win. So the reason why I say round three is because I don't think Paolo's going to have the gas to last five rounds.
Right.
If he can last five rounds and they both have the conditioning, it'll be an insane five-round fight. And if it goes back and forth, like my third option, that would be amazing. That's the fight I think we all want to see, is them trading blows and Adesanya, you know, hitting a couple of counters well, but then Paolo coming in and hitting a couple of shots up against the cage, you know. That's what we want to see. But if Paolo, we've never seen Paolo last five rounds. We've seen him go three. And he was gassed. And the only reason he made the three rounds with Romero is because they had to break because he got stabbed in the fucking eye socket, right? It's like, so if he had to do all three rounds consecutively, I don't think he would have lasted the three rounds.
It's an interesting thing because we see him slow down. But here's the thing is that I think five-round and three-round fights, like the one thing, and this is, I mean, every MMA guy says this, so I'm just kind of following the narrative, but if you look at a fighter like Costa, who, you know, and you look at all his three-round fights versus Izzy, who's been champion for a while, so you have five-round footage, and you also have his extensive Glory kickboxing career where you can see him go similar and maybe even further distances. I don't even remember kickboxing timings, but you got to also keep in mind that, like, the Yoel Romero versus Costa fight. You know, if you and I are fighting, we're fighting for a three-round fight.
Yeah.
In the third then, round,
you hit it to high gear round one already. You don't plan to last five rounds. I mean, I get that 100% because you could see in that fight they were going. They were going round one already. They weren't feeling it out. They were fucking on it from round one. So I get that. The only thing that worries me is Costa's style kind of depends on him going 100% from the get-go, if you know what I mean. He doesn't really feel that out. That's not really how that's why I say if someone's gonna gas, I feel like it'll have to be him, unless he makes Adesanya work really fucking hard to get out of the way the whole time. But my point is, like, his style is kind of dependent on him being aggressive and forward the whole time, and so I feel like if it's like Izzy, his style is like he can afford to kind of hang back and wait for opportunities, right? So he could afford to have round one go slowly, you know? But I feel like Costa, his style, I don't know if he'd want round one to go slowly, you know? I feel like he would want to try and get in as many hits as possible. But maybe he changes up his strategy. I'm just going off of what we see.
I have a feeling for Costa, like, look, he might come out guns blazing, but I have a feeling that the thing is that what we've learned about Izzy, at least, is that you look at the Romero versus Izzy fight, is that if someone takes their time with Izzy, he'll fucking take his time right back. If Costa decides to come out a little bit slower, I don't think Izzy's going to feel the overwhelming urge to make something out.
He might
feel it from his last fight. So, but the thing is that
I'd feel the need just because his last fight, people hated the Romero Izzy fight because it was boring as fuck. It's like you can't sit through more than two rounds of that thing without getting completely fucking bored.
It's better. It's better than fucking Quaaludes. But yeah, so I mean, in regards,
I feel like eyes will be on Izzy to some extent to make sure something happens. But then again, people are saying just because of how Costa fights, it's like I really don't expect it to be boring because, like, Costa isn't going to change his style all of a sudden. It's like it works for him. No one's been able to lay him out, even though he's always forward. You know, it's like, we have people who have defensive styles, but no one has been able to lay him out. But no one's been as good as Izzy, right? But I don't think he's going to change his style because his advantage as a guy who's bigger and strong is to hit the hard shots. You know what I mean? That's going to be... Again, I think Costa's game plan, if he just wants to win, should be take it to the ground. But everyone knows he's not going to do that because I think he... he wants to beat Izzy standing. But I mean, if he wanted to win, I would say just take it to the fucking ground, because I don't see a situation there where Izzy would whoop him.
Well, but the thing is that the reason why it's dangerous enough is that for a counter striker like Izzy, you don't want to, you know, you just do not want to be in a position where a takedown is predictable. And unless you're someone who easily and seamlessly transitions your strikes to your takedowns or your defense.
Yeah, like Khabib.
It's a risky, like Khabib.
I feel like Costa, imagine if you could mix Costa and Khabib into like one fighter.
It would be a nice mix mash of styles. I think because they're both forward. The one's a forward pressure striker. The one's a forward pressure grappler.
It's a brutal style. You'd have a good package, because he'd just be like, if a guy's good standing, then he'd just take him down. And if the guy's good on the ground, he would just keep fucking standing. You know, I think it would be quite a
genius take, Ruben. But what I will say.
I'm sorry. I'm fanboying out about this because I'm really excited for the fight, because I really want to see how this goes.
I know. I'm not gonna make funny.
I'm fucking fanboying out.
No, dude. I respect it. What I will say is that I wouldn't be surprised. I think Costa is, you know, while we're looking at all of the lead up and we're looking at the promos, and it's easy to kind of get emotional with the fighters. You think, fuck, he wants to take his head off. But I think Costa, I'd like to think that for both of them, I mean, you know, like, talk aside, they're smart enough that strategy implements. I wouldn't be surprised if it's a 5-round fight. I mean, don't be astounded if they do actually take a little bit of time off in the first and actually feel each other out and see where it's going to go. The real question, I think the real interesting question is for me is that, On paper, Costa does have a disadvantage in the striking. And we don't see an awful lot of Costa's grappling inside the octagon. But we know that he is an accomplished grappler. And interestingly, what I wanted to speak to you about is that I'm not sure if you know who Henry Cejudo is. Obviously, the MMA fans clicking on this video is now. Henry Cejudo is recently retired, but he's not really retired. It's just a little bit of a scheme. But he was bantamweight and flyweight champion, double champ at the same time of the UFC.
Oh, okay. Now I know who it is. Also
2008.
But he wasn't the first guy to have two division titles, was he?
No, he wasn't. He wasn't the first.
But he did have both, yeah. But he did have both. Okay, yes, I know who he is now.
Yeah, and he has an Olympic gold medal in wrestling. Now, what's interesting is that I think they have the same manager, they have the same wrestling coach, and Henry Cejudo is in the training camp, training with Paulo Costa. Henry being such an insanely accomplished wrestler, I wouldn't be surprised if we see Costa mix it up in this fight. And it would be interesting.
That's actually a good point. Because, to be honest with you, I don't really see Izzy winning if Paulo takes it to the ground. That might be a very controversial thing to say. But yeah, sorry, continue. I interrupted you there.
No. I can see Izzy slipping out of Costa's takedowns, or at least not winning the grappling exchanges, but disengaging from the grappling exchanges and finding space to stand back up. Because the one thing that you look about Costa is that, as an offensive wrestler, when I watch his wrestling sessions, and look, I know nothing because I don't have enough footage of Costa to actually say this, but it looks like as an offensive wrestler, he doesn't keep people down incredibly well, but as a defensive wrestler, he has fantastic base. So what that means is that for this fight with Izzy, who has such a speed advantage, it might be a case where he won't look for takedowns because it's going to be too much energy to get the takedown and to keep him down without Izzy exploding back to his feet. That's one possibility. Or it happens fucking close to the cage, or it happens in the middle of the octagon. Yeah. And now Izzy's in close guard, and he has an enormous middleweight on top of him. And that's where a physical strength and a little bit of a size difference might show in some grappling situations. I wonder if maybe
it might be that Costa's going to go, because I think he wants to beat him standing. A lot of it is talk and smack talk between fucking fighters. But I think in this fight, there's a lot. Look, because here's the thing. Izzy plays the game super well. He knows. I mean, Chael Sonnen always says in his videos, like, at the end of the fight, you want to call out the next fight, you know? You want to call out the next guy you want to kick, you know? And I feel like Izzy's good at that, because, like, that's what he did off the Romero fight with Costa. You know, he's kind of been, he's good at that. But, and so there's a business aspect to it as well, right? The reason they have all the smack talk and shit. But I do feel like this one is kind of a little bit personal. And just because it has gone to Izzy being like, Paolo, you're fucking on roids and I want to whip your ass before you, you know, you soda pops, you know, stuff like that. I feel like,
yeah.
So I feel like Costa wants to beat him standing, but it might be that he goes round 1, 2, and 3 and tries to beat him standing. And then if he can't, he switches to grappling in the later rounds just to get the win. You know, to get the submission instead of having it go to points. Because let's be honest, if it lasts 5 rounds and it goes to points, like, let's say it ends up being the glorious fight everyone wants it to be, including me, and it's just them trading blows and going at it for 5 rounds and it goes to points, it's going to be a toss-up, you know?
Yeah, maybe.
And I feel like Izzy might have the advantage then, simply because his counter-striking is so good that he's probably going to land more shots because Paolo's going to throw more and land less. So at least the ratio between shots thrown and shots landed is going to be way better for Izzy than it will for Costa. So, and I'm not exactly sure how it scored in MMA. I just know how it scored in boxing.
Well, the thing is that total strikes do matter, but there's obviously a big debate between significant strikes and total strikes. It just depends. Exactly. It's going to particularly depend who's going to be dropping who, but I do think on a volume level alone, striking volume could win Israel rounds. Even though he's very calm and measured, he'll land little inside leg kicks. He'll land little jabs on the entry and jabs on the exit, and they might not cause huge damage, but it's going to accumulate.
It wouldn't necessarily be necessary either that he's landing more punches. I feel like Paolo might actually in number just land more because he's thrown more. But the thing is he's going to have to throw so many more punches to be able to land those that it's because I think Izzy will throw less. So what will happen is his percentage, you know, of thrown to touch punch is going to be way higher. Obviously, just because he's a defensive striker. So there might be for him, say a 50% chance that what he throws is going to hit. Whereas for Costa, it might be 25%. You know, so that means that's theoretically, I'm not saying those are the numbers, but just like if you had to theoretically say that means Paolo has to throw 4 times the amount of punches to make the same amount of hits, you know, so it might be, it might just be in that sense, quite a difficult thing. But I don't know. I'm just speaking on an Excel spreadsheet type of vibe here. But I mean, look, I would say. Yeah, no, you go talking.
Well, what I'm gonna say is that I have to literally leave in fucking 3 minutes. What I will say
does load shedding not start at 10 o'clock there?
No, but that's what I literally just told you before the podcast. I've got a Russian like 5 minutes earlier. Fucking, you know, boil kettles. Fucking charge things up. I gotta
get. Okay.
This is you outside.
Peasant talkers. Just drink the coffee with hot water from the geyser.
Oh Jesus, yeah, dude. Literally just caffeinate your piss, bro. What the
fuck? Exactly, come on, dude.
Like just
don't caffeinate your weak piss.
What's wrong with it? So look, final thing.
By the way, I'm going benching tomorrow to test my Mac so that I can get on this program with you. Just to let you know. Anyway.
Which is gonna start literally Monday next week.
And essentially what we're gonna do is we're gonna see who makes the most improvement. That's the competition.
Is that the competition? And it's between us.
Well, or who benches more, because we'll see how weak I am. It might end up that I end up being exactly the same as you because I haven't benched in so long.
No, dude, that's literally impossible.
Oh, yeah. Let's wrap this up. Yeah, what do you want to say?
What I'm going to wrap this up is with you and I. What would be fun is I think we should have, I want to play, like, I don't know if it's going to be a betting game with you, but we need to make this fun, let's both have a prediction. And my prediction is, I can't choose between the second or the third round. I'm gonna be daring, and I'm gonna go third round TKO Adesanya.
Is it? Yeah. I feel like it wouldn't be a TKO. I feel like it would be a KO if it is going to be one, to be honest with you. I feel like if one of them's going to get knocked, it's going to be a KO. Because I don't think... I think if Paolo gets knocked down, he's going to fucking get back up. Vice versa. I feel like if Paolo gets knocked, it's not going to be a TKO. He'll pull something out of his fucking ass. But his
chin is just so good that he would literally only get swarmed by shots and not physically be unconscious. But who knows? Maybe. Who knows?
I get you. But okay, I'm going to make this because I want Costa to win. So, although I think on paper, you probably have the edge on me. I'm going to put my faith in Costa, although it's hard.
Okay.
I'm going to say...
I want you to be...
because I feel like Costa will either finish him round two or three, or it'll go the distance and Costa will win in the end because I have faith in the big boy.
Pick a round. Okay. I'm saying third round, TKO.
Should I say two or three? I don't know. There's so many fucking variables, Tarquin.
You got to think, dude.
Okay. Let's go round three knockout, not TKO, knockout.
Really? Round three knockout. So both of us in the third round.
Okay, yeah. Hell yes. Here's the thing. I think Israel. Oh, hang on. Let me think of this way. Israel might be able to TKO Costa, but I feel like if Costa hits Israel right, it'll be a knockout. He doesn't have big enough traps to stop the knockout from happening. His neck is going to fucking swivel. But I'm talking shit. So for you haters in the comments, don't get too angry with me, okay?
Exactly.
But anyway.
And that wraps it up, folks. This is the Brewcast Benching Challenge coming up next week. When them pecs be popping, them fucking
the panties be dropping on the loose.
So hell yeah. Dude, fucking Jackson.
Let me show this. For people who are like all traps, I'm like, look at this, dude. Romero doesn't have shit on these traps.
I can only see your shoulder. Don't you want to move to the right? Move to the right. There we go, dude.
Romero doesn't have shit on this, dude. You know what? Maybe I'm not natural. Maybe I'm not natural. Who knows?
He's flirting with the idea of his performance enhancing drugs. Listen, don't make me call you Sada on the boxing match.
Dude, did you hear that? Apparently Costa says you Sada haven't tested him once this prep. It makes 100% sense. Really? Remember, we both said Paolo's on something. And we have a video on it, so you guys check that out. But Paolo said he hasn't been tested once by USADA this whole prep, this whole fight camp.
They've been kind.
Which tells me maybe that's why he's gained another extra 10 pounds of fucking mass. Instead of taking the usual, he's fucking popping Anavar too. He's throwing on some hectic shit to gain some mass for the fight, my guy.
Fuck yes.
Anyway, okay. Cheers, bro.
Hell yeah.
See you guys next time. Like and subscribe for more podcast episodes, and goodbye.